It's great to welcome back Steve Lindy, the editor of the Jerusalem Report, for an interview with Yuval Steinitz, Israel's Minister of Energy and Water Resources.
Minister Yuval Steinitz, what are Israel's goals in terms of solar energy, and do you expect interest from the UAE and other Gulf states?
First, it's a pleasure to be here with you. And with regard to renewables and solar energy, we made a tremendous progress in the last 3 or 4 years. According to the International Energy Organization, we are already number 2 in the world in the production of electricity from solar energy, from the sun. And about 9% of our electricity is already produced, is already solar energy. But we put a new goal to reach 30% renewables. In our case, it's actually 30% solar energy. We don't have renewables. We have renewable solar energy. That's the only renewable we have. To reach 30%, which might put us number 1 in the world. Using so much solar energy will enable us, together with natural gas, to completely terminate the use of coal and other polluting fuels like diesel or solar in our power stations 5 years from now. And I can tell you that we are very proud to be number 1 in the world in the speed of reducing and terminating the use of coal. In 2012, more than 60% of our electricity was produced with polluting coal. Today, this year, it will be around 20%, and in 2025, it will be zero. It will be totally replaced with natural gas and solar energy.
In the field of natural gas, what impact has Chevron's entry into the market had on Israel, and do you expect interest in this from the Gulf states?
Look, in the past, the majors and the big energy oil and gas companies were hesitant to invest in Israel. And now, maybe also the Abraham Accords also helped this to happen with the Chevron, which is currently the biggest oil and gas company in the world, entering Israel, investing in Israel. This is extremely important, because I think that Chevron might seriously examine and maybe participate in the ambitious project of the East Med gas pipeline that will enable Israel and Cyprus to export gas directly to Europe through a cross-Mediterranean pipeline. It's going to be the longest and deepest undersea gas pipeline in the world. And also, speaking about regional cooperation, actually, we already started. Israel is already exporting natural gas to its neighbors, to Egypt and Jordan. But I believe that Chevron, which is so active all over the region and also in Europe, it will help us to promote regional cooperation. And I hope that Chevron will also invest not just in natural gas, but also in Israeli startups and technological companies, because, speaking about renewables, the future of renewables is heavily dependent on research and development and new innovation. Israel has been known to be startup nations for several decades now. Actually, we have more technological startups per capita than any other country in the world. And even in complete numbers, and this is really overwhelming, in little Israel, you have more technological startups than all of the European Union together. Huh. If you take Germany and France and Holland and Sweden and Spain and Italy and many other countries, in little Israel, there are more technological startups. And in the last 3 or 4 years, hundreds of new startups began to focus on the field of energy, cybersecurity for the energy sector, energy efficiency, new methods of electricity storage, hydrogen cells, and so on and so forth. We have already, I think, close to 1,000 startups in the field of energy and related issues. And I believe that Chevron might invest in this vibrant innovation theme in Israel as well. And this will be very good, of course.
Israel is also a world leader in water and water desalination. Do you expect interest from the Gulf states in this field?
Yes, but I think that our main contribution can be not necessarily in desalination, but in the recycling of sewage water, of wastewater. Just to give you the figures, today we are desalinating more than 80% of our drinking water. So actually, instead of consuming nature, lakes, rivers, drilling into the ground, we desalinate most of our water from the ocean, from the Mediterranean. What is more significant even, and more unique, that then, after using the water, we recycle close to 95% of our wastewater, of our sewage. We take it, we purify it, we recycle it, and then we use it for farming and agriculture and parks and so on and so forth. I think the second country in the world is Spain, with about 30% recycling. And this is extremely important because actually you double the amount of water. First you use them for drinking or households, and then you recycle them for farming and agriculture. But you also avoid many pollution, sewage pollution around the country. And here we are really unique, and of course we are happy to share our experience with the Gulf countries.
You are also an expert on Iran. With a new president entering the White House, how concerned are you about Iran and its violations of the nuclear deal?
I think we are very concerned. And Gulf countries, and actually Europe and the rest of the world should be concerned as well. You know, Iran jumped from 3.7% enrichment level to 20%. Mm-hmm. Many people say, okay, but they have to reach to 90%, so it's only 20% of the way. But this is totally wrong. It's 90% of the way. Why? Because at nature, the uranium you need is 0.7%, the fissile uranium. To get from 0.7% to 20%, you have to double it 30 or 35 times. For 20% to 90%, it's another three. You have to double it only three times more. So actually, you already doubled it by 30 times, and what left is only three times. So you actually, when you enrich enough material for 20%, you are already made 90% of the way to fissile material that is needed to nuclear weapons. And therefore, this is very alarming, and the world, hopefully under the new leadership of the new president, President Biden, have to put enormous pressure on Iran to stop and to withdraw from its nuclear program, which is the only aim of their nuclear program is to produce nuclear weapons. This is clear to anybody, to everybody.
Now you have a close relationship with Joe Biden. Tell us a little bit about that and how you see Israel-U.S. ties developing under his presidency.
Well, I happened to meet President-elect Joe Biden several times in Israel, in Europe, and also at the White House. And he was also always extremely friendly to the state of Israel, extremely committed. You know, in the past, he defined himself when he was a senator, yet as a devoted Zionist. And actually, in I think it was in 2014, as a minister for strategic affairs, I was invited by Biden to meet him at the White House following 3 days of talks in the State Department and in Washington to discuss several issues, including, of course, the nuclear deal with Iran, which was negotiated then in 2014. And I raised our reservations about the forthcoming agreement and what should be what is needed in order to fix it. And it was very, very serious and friendly discussion. So I believe that Biden, I'm confident, will remain a friend of Israel, will remain committed to prevent Iran from getting nuclear weapons. Actually, he was committed to this goal together with President Obama just 5-6 years ago. And we will have to create a new dialogue with a new administration in Washington. And hopefully, they will put pressure on Iran. And if they are going to a new agreement, it will be a better and improved agreement. Our approach is very clear. It's not enough to freeze the Iranian nuclear program. You have to dismantle it, to roll it back in order to make not just the Middle East, but the entire world a safer.
Well, that seems like a good place to end it. Thank you so much for joining us, Cabinet Minister Yuval Steinitz.
You are most welcome.